Here I am in 1990. You had a hard-headed Cajun and hard-headed old-school general manager.
He picked a fight with, you know, the Cajun cannon, and he picked a fight with a guy that wasn't going to bow down to him.
When you lose your starting quarterback, a good player and a good guy and a leader, it hurts.
Let's go back to where it all started. It was around 1985. The USFL folded, and Bobby Hebert was eyeing his shot in the NFL. At the time, Hebert was ready to sign with the Seattle Seahawks, a four-year deal worth $2 million and a $500,000 signing bonus, until he received a call from Louisiana Governor Edwin Edwards.
He goes, you don't need to go up there. There's no cages up there. You need to come back home. Mr. Benson just bought the team. And so my agent, I called him up, and he goes, no, listen, we need to come back to New Orleans. We're going to get more than what Seattle wants to pay. And I thought it was unbelievable.
And he was right. Benson offered Hebert an even bigger signing bonus at $750,000.
And then my agent, Greg Campbell, says, no, that's not enough. And you know, you never want to let him see you sweat. So I'm like thinking, what? Then all of a sudden, I got a signing bonus for $1.2 million. It was the largest signing bonus in NFL history. I couldn't believe it, to see a check for $1.2 million.
Go right!
Hebert agreed to the contract, and from there, flew straight to Ruston, Louisiana, for Saints training camp to begin preparing for the 85 season. By 1987, Hebert earned the starting job and led the Saints to its first 12-3 season and first playoff game under head coach Jim Mora. After the 1989 season, Hebert's contract was up. Enter Jim Finks.
Jim Finks was our president and GM, and he was as good as there is. I mean, he was great in the Pro Football Hall of Fame, as he should be.
He gave this team credibility and something that they had never had before, leadership at the top. But Jim was hard-headed.
At that point in the NFL, quarterbacks were not signing multi-year deals up to $500 million like Patrick Mahomes is now. And no one on the 1989 team had $1 million salary. But Hebert knew what he was worth and what he wanted. Finks knew what he was willing to give.
I looked over a three-year period where I was ranked, and I told Mr. Finks, the market value is right under like $1.3 million. He goes, well, I'm not gonna pay you that because we all knew we could pay you whatever we want. And so I said, well, pay me the market value, I'm not playing. So lo and behold, the union, the players union, we filed an antitrust lawsuit.
He was a late entry. His name wasn't on the case itself because of the fact that sitting out the 1990 season, this had been brought up in 89, but there was a reason why he was the last guy to be on the witness stand. While he was giving his testimony, the lawyers for the NFL were sending notes to Gene Upshaw about, we need to settle this.
And they did. At roughly $200 million.
And all I did was, I said, how could somebody own you if you don't have a contract? We come the next offseason, Coach Morris said, I won't sign the extension until you bring Bobby Hebert back at quarterback. So not only did Mr. Finks not want to pay me $1 million, but he paid me right under $1.8 million for that 91 season. So I had my cake and eat it too.
And Finks became the major player in there. I think that ruling that went in the favor of the players and opened up the gates for free agency cost Jim Finks the commissioner's job. And who would have thought the main character in there is a guy from La Rose, Louisiana?
Hebert finished out his career with the Atlanta Falcons after Finks refused to re-sign him in 1993. For Your Go Black and Gold, I'm Brooke Kirchhoffer.